So, then the topic today is frequentist distribution theory of the GLM, of course. And let's first briefly rehearse where we are at. So, of course, we're talking about the GLM all the time, and we've seen that the GLM can be written if I manage to turn on the math, can be written as this equation here, where our epsilon is multivariate normally distributed, centered on zero, and has a spherical covariance matrix. And we have discussed at some length that this corresponds to the assumption that our data, so our n-dimensional data vectors y, are distributed according to a multivariate normal distribution with expectation parameter given by x beta. Or maybe I should do like this if we're talking about the probability density function, and spherical covariance matrix. And we have then introduced last time that we assume that there are true but unknown values, parameter values, namely the true but unknown effect sizes. In undergraduate statistics, you might have called them population parameters, but if you are analyzing fMRI data and you are interested in the effect that a certain experimental manipulation, like showing faces, has on the Bold signal, and you are interested in estimating this effect size, then I don't know why anyone would call this population parameter. It's a true but unknown effect size that you try to estimate. We assumed last time that they are there, and of course generate your observed data set. And then for a given observed data set, we established estimators for the parameters. That we denoted by hats. So we established something like beta hat, which we derive from a maximum likelihood viewpoint to be given by this product of design matrix, matrix and data, which also corresponds to the ordinary least squares estimator, as explained. And we introduced the variance parameter estimate that derives from, or corresponds to, the residual. Always do that. The residual sum of squares, so the data minus the design matrix times the maximum likelihood, maximum likelihood or ordinary least squares estimator, and all of these multiplied by themselves and summed up, which in vector notation then takes the form that I'm just writing up here. And this divided by 1 over n minus p, to make it unbiased, so to make it a good estimate of this variance parameter. So this is where we actually are in terms of our understanding of the GLM. So we of course know what all these symbols refer to, what their sizes are in terms of their matrices and so on. And we can now estimate the true but unknown parameters, which is a good thing. So once we observed some data, we can say, okay, our estimate of the two effect sizes is that and that, in terms of, for example, a Gaussian GLM, so sampling just a Gaussian, this our effect size would be the expected value of this Gaussian, so our population parameter in terms of a simple linear regression design. Our beta parameters would be the slope and the offset parameters. In terms of multiple linear regression, this would be all our beta parameters, and as we will see then later in terms of our ANOVAs, these are the expectations of our different cells, of our possibly factorial designs. And we can estimate the parameter governing the variance of the error. So we can say something, but then you also know that in statistics one sometimes or often wants to say something a little bit more, namely one wants to do some null hypothesis testing in the frequentist setting, and for that one needs to talk about the distribution of the estimators. And what one also needs to, or what one can also then introduce based on the estimates are other statistics, for example the t-statistic, which is a ratio of the effect size and the variance, and the f-statistics, which are model comparison criterion. And these t and f-statistics, they rest on the evaluating of the parameter estimates. And so we now want to, before we go into the examples, in the last weeks, 5 weeks or so of the term, want to, yeah, go a little bit beyond estimating the true but unknown parameters, but studying their frequentist distributions. This is the aim for today, and then next week introduce the notion of hypothesis testing, so that you know at least to a certain degree why or what the background is to people saying there's a massive multiple testing problem in FMI. And people like to say that, and of course it only makes sense to say something like this if testing is introduced, and so on. Okay, before we go on, or maybe before we go on, let's briefly say what we want to do today. So what I want to discuss is the frequentist sampling intuition. That's the first thing. So frequentist sampling intuition. The next thing that I want to introduce are the frequentist distributions of the estimates or estimators, beta hat and sigma square hat. And ideally, I do that before the break, and after the break, introduce the t-statistic and its frequentist distribution. So that's the aim for today. Before we start with that, are there any questions regarding to what we have on the slide up here? So the 1, 2, 3 we will discuss today, but the things that are here on the slide you should be happy with and familiar with. So is there anything left unclear regarding these first three lines?
Yeah, I have a question about why the identity matrix shows up. Is that what I sub n is?
That's the identity matrix, yeah.
Yeah, is that because it's like the covariance instead of the variance, or?
You should,
I was trying to figure it out, but it just sort of showed up all of a sudden and I couldn't figure
well,
out.
Well, it didn't really show up all of a sudden, so it showed up when we discussed spherical covariance matrices and the equivalence. So when it shows up is, and that's where this is coming from, it shows up when, well, let me go down here. Or does anyone know where it's coming from? So let's do this interactive. Can anyone help your colleague? So where does the identity matrix come from, and why is it there? Anyone? Hello? So it showed up in the session on probability distributions, and the idea was, well, we can do it, maybe let's refocus on the error terms. So the idea was that each of these error terms, so the entries of epsilon, has a univariate Gaussian distribution centered on zero and has the same variance parameter. Yeah, so the error contributions to the expected value for each of our yi are given by univariate Gaussians. So of course these are the error terms that in yi are added to the respective entry in the vector formed by the product of the design matrix and the beta parameters. And what we then showed in the probability distribution session was that assuming independence of these error contributions and the probability of the joint distribution of these error distributions, that's one way we can do it. I think we did it in more in a more general setting. So if we look at the joint distribution of all the errors, so this is of course then a n-dimensional distribution. If we assume independence of the errors, then this of course corresponds to the product of all their densities. So these are all multiplied, which of course we can just write like this. Oops. And then so this was the independence assumption of the error terms, and of course each epsilon I has as a probability density the Gaussian. So what we have here is actually the product of n Gaussian univariate Gaussian distributions, so the ones that you know from undergrad statistics. So these are univariate ones. And then we showed, and that was the whole thing about introducing multivariate Gaussians, that this product of n univariate Gaussian probability density functions is the same as a multivariate Gaussian distribution with expectation parameter given by a vector of zeros, so 0n, and a spherical covariance matrix. So where of course, and this then this should of course be clear from the context, as one always says. This here is a univariate Gaussian, which you can tell by that this is a scalar and this is a scalar, and this is a multivariate Gaussian, and this epsilon I here is of course just the concatenation of all the epsilons. So epsilon below is then epsilon, and we might write this as I. And if you want to be somewhat unspecific, this is n. Yeah. So essentially, what I just reminded you of is that this spherical covariance matrix here, so the covariance matrix parameter in this multivariate Gaussian of this random vector epsilon, corresponds to the assumption that the error terms are all independent and identically distributed according to a univariate Gaussian centered on zero and with variance parameter sigma square. Yeah. So that's the session on probability distributions.
Great, yeah. Thank you.
Yeah. Good. Anything else?
There were a couple study questions for last week's session that addressed differentiating between OLS and ML estimators. And yeah, so I wanted to kind of like further inquire if you could you did address that in last week's session a bit, but specifically in relation to what was it? Sorry, now I have my probability distributions notes open, so I have to switch back to last week. Right, differentiating between the sum of error squares and the residual sum of squares. My intuition, also from reading the notes, is that and doing a little bit of additional reading, that the main differentiation between
You
the two
shouldn't do
is,
additional reading.
yeah.
No, you
No, yeah.
shouldn't.
Oh, I
Because
should. Oh.
because it might be different when you do it, you see it somewhere else. So the difference between residual sum of squares and error sum of squares is just whether in this equation here you have the better head, then it's called the residual sum of squares. And if you have the true but unknown parameter, then it's called error sum of squares, and I think I abbreviate this by SES, right? That's how I do it in the script. So that's the difference.
Okay, there's not a difference with respect to probabilistic inference, for example, versus not, or no. Okay, that was what some stuff online was saying, but that's
There's
okay.
a lot of stuff online. So the yeah, sure, of course it helps to read things somewhere, but there's also a lot of crap online. So the script and the study question should be self-coherent. That's a little bit different maybe than in the new cognitive methods course, because there's a lot of people have written on these things, and a lot of people have written good things on these things. But if you specifically, if you go to these simple tutorials online, then things can go wrong quite easily. So yeah, so residual sum of squares is just once you have your estimates and you look at the deviation between your observed data and the prediction of your model, and the error sum of squares is just the analytical quantity, that's the deviation between the data and the prediction as a function of the beta parameters.
Okay, so there's no further kind of like attributions that can be ascribed to the association between SES and OLS and
SES and OLS. So ordinary least squares is. I'm afraid if we have to go on. Can we?
Yeah,
Otherwise, we
that's okay.
don't.
All
So
right.
sorry. Questions are welcome, but they need to. Sorry, need to be short. So we can, of course. Maybe we open up the Q&A at Neural Cognitive Methods also for statistics. So if questions start piling up in statistics, maybe we should also address them there. Because so ordinary least squares, read what is in the script, and this is all you need. And if there are questions regarding what's in the script regarding ordinary least squares estimation, which we briefly touched upon only, we can discuss that in the Q&A for neural cognitive methods. But the only point of OLS in the script is to show that the maximum likelihood estimator is the same as the OLS estimator for the beta parameters.
All right, thank you.
Yeah. Good. So then let's rather start now with the topics for today. So let's just get rid of this. So the first thing to discuss is the frequentist sampling intuition of the GLM, but also, of course, in general, frequentist statistics. And this is quite important because it underlies the whole idea of In the end, hypothesis testing, but also the idea of studying the quality of estimators, which we don't do here. But yeah, the whole notion of frequentist statistics rests on this sampling intuition, and that's important specifically if one comes to statistics from the applied perspective of wanting to analyze some data. And in data analysis, you of course always have one data set, and that's what you're dealing with, and that's what you apply your parameter estimation routines and everything to. So what do I mean by this frequentist sampling intuition? So the we discuss it now for the GLM, but this applies to any kind of statistical model that you study from a frequentist perspective. So and it actually also applies to models that you study from a Bayesian perspective when you think about the likelihood. And then you can do nice mixtures between frequentist and Bayesian statistics, and then it actually gets interesting. So what's the frequentist sampling intuition? What we've established so far is, and that's what's up here, is that we assume that the data vector, so always remember that y is a vector and takes on values in the n-dimensional real numbers. So one example for that is of course something like this. Let me create a matrix where you have, let's say, 10 data points corresponding to 10 participants, and maybe corresponding to some reading on these participants. So for example, I don't know what you guys like, but maybe their empathy score. So let's assume you have a questionnaire, and then you evaluate this questionnaire, and for each participant now get a score how empathetic they are. And let's assume that the first participant was fairly empathetic and the last participant was not so much. So you have 10 numbers. So that's one of your data sets. Of course, in neural imaging, what these data are rather time series. For example, the time series of one voxel in fMRI over all the volumes that you acquire, so the MR signal readings, as we will discuss this afternoon. So I just want to put some brackets around this, but that's apparently not that trivial. So that's one data set that you may have acquired. There should also be brackets around that. Now, the probabilistic machinery that we've developing here and the whole idea of frequentist statistics, of course, has a little bit more than that. You only will ever have one data set, because it says that your observed data, and maybe let's call your observed data Y star to make this really clear here. Your observed data, or let's call this Y1, is one of the many samples that you could take from the model that you assume here. So you have one realization of this model. That's the data that you have stored on your machine and that you acquired from your participants. But the probabilistic framework you're dealing with says that this is one of the samples you could take from the model. And in principle, if you knew, and what it also says is that this sample derives from the true but unknown beta and sigma square parameters that exist out there in the world. Yeah, so that's here your observed data. So 10 numbers that you have stored in some Excel file. Now the probabilistic framework says that this is one sample that you could can obtain, but it describes the distribution of these random variables. So in principle, of course, you could also do that in real life. If you say, okay, I took a sample of 10 participants now, then I wait a day and then I take a new sample of 10 participants and get data again. So in a way you can also do what the model says in real life, but the model obviously describes the distribution, and if you implement this on a computer using a random number generator, then you can of course easily again sample data. And sampling data always means here sampling n data points, yeah? So don't confuse these y1, y2, y3 or so with single numbers. These are always 10 numbers if you're dealing with an observed data set comprising 10 numbers. And the frequentist sampling intuition is just that. Based on the model that you assume, you get a distribution over data that you can repeatedly sample. Again, in real life, you usually only have one sample. Sometimes nowadays people take two samples to do a replication study. And then they get a lot of applause because they replicated something. But of course, the frequentist intuition and the logic does not actually need another sample in real life. It applies to every single sample and evaluates each data sample based on the analytical properties of the data distribution. Now, if you sample a new data set, so that's your, maybe let's this be your observed data, but then you sample a new one in theory, or just think about these as hypothetical samples, then for each data set you can of course evaluate your estimators. Yeah, so if you have your data set Y1, then you apply your design matrix product to Y1 and you get a better hat estimate 1. And in real life, so if you do this based on your observed data here, this would be your only better parameter estimates that you will ever see. In the theory of the probabilistic model, you can of course evaluate your better hat estimator for each of your data samples, and hence for each of your data samples get a better hat estimator. And of course you can also for each of your data samples evaluate your variance estimator. Then it just gets a little bit notation wise not that nice, because you have the square and an index referring to the sample, but we can live with it. And as we will see later on, t-values are functions of beta parameter estimates and variance parameter estimates. So we can also at this point already state that we can sample multiple data points, multiple parameters, and then also multiple t-values. How t-values relate to parameter estimates we will see later on. Now, what we have introduced so far is, of course, the distribution of the data. Yeah? So we know how the data is distributed because that's everything that we did so far. We developed the GLM. So maybe we put it down here and organize it like this. Now, we spent some time when we discussed probability distribution, when we discussed random variables, we spent some time on transformations of random variables. Namely the fact what happens if you apply some function to a random variable and what you can say about the outcome or the distribution of the outcome of this transformation. And clearly when we look at the parameter estimates, we apply some function to the data, namely we multiply it by this yeah, design matrix product here, or we yeah, do a little bit more, but we apply a function to the data. And when we discussed transformations, we saw that we then can of course under certain conditions, so that the functions are essentially invertible and that we have probability densities for our random variables and so on, we can say something about the distribution of our transformed values. And now frequentist distribution theory is just that, namely it's making statements about the distributions of these transformed random variables. So we're trying to find an answer to the question of how is better hat distributed. And similarly, we try to answer the question of how sigma square is distributed. And from these, we also try to answer the question how the t statistic is distributed. And why are we doing this? Of course, because we want in the end to do something like hypothesis testing, where we assume something about the true but unknown parameters, for example that they are zero, and then we ask, okay, if we assume that our true but unknown parameter beta parameters are zero, how is beta hat then distributed, how is sigma square distributed, how is our t distributed? Okay, we know that. Now we've observed a certain t. How likely is is it to observe such a t value or a more extreme t value under the assumption that our beta parameters are zero? And then we find an answer based on these analytical distributions, and this answer then we call a p-value. So this is what where p-values come from. But before we can talk about how t random variables are distributed, we need to discuss how beta parameter estimates are distributed from a frequentist perspective and how variance parameter estimates are distributed from a frequentist perspective. So that's the frequentist sampling intuition. And today the core, actually we have to cut it a little bit short there, the core message is that we can derive the distributions of these estimates and these statistics based on the theory of how the transformations of random variables are distributed. And then turns out that beta hat is distributed also according to a multivariate normal distribution, which is actually centered on the true but unknown beta parameter value. And oops, this is a typo here, and this is a cat. Which is centered on the true but unknown beta parameter value, and which has a covariance matrix that is given by the inverse of this design matrix product times the true but unknown variance parameter. So this is in the script what you see as theorem 9.21, the beta parameter estimate distribution, which in the proof you see just is a direct consequence of the linear fine transformation theorem for Gaussian distributions, which we discussed when we discussed Gaussian distributions. So it's fairly straightforward. You just need to apply that theorem. So it's in the proof is quite short, as you can see. The point is that these beta parameter estimates, they are of course usually more than one dimensional. They are centered on the true but unknown parameters. in the p-dimensional space that the beta parameters live in, and they have a covariance matrix that scales with the variance of the data. There's actually a sigma square missing. That scales with the covariance or the variance parameter of the data. So if you have higher data variance, also your beta parameter estimates vary more, and the covariance, which is also dependent on the design matrix. So you can do, and this is kind of a topic then in multiple linear regression and also simple linear regression, you can in a way optimize your design in such a way to manipulate the covariance or the variance of your beta parameter estimates, not only by having low errors anyway, so having low variance in your errors, which is a thing that you cannot control, that's given by nature, but what you can control is your design matrix, and you can kind of make sure that your design matrix does not induce more error in your estimates than absolutely necessary. There is also a visualization of that in the script for the case of a simple linear regression design. So that's what we see here. So can you see that? Do you see a? I guess you see it here.
Yes.
Yeah, good. So you have a simple linear regression here, where of course you have in the design matrix a column of ones and a column of zeros to nine in discrete steps, and this shows the expected value, and it shows I think 10 or 20 samples of that. So all these little lines here that go a little bit around this thicker line here, or with the larger markers, these are samples taken from the simple linear regression design with true but unknown parameters of beta 1 corresponding to 1 and beta 2, so the offset and the slope parameter both corresponding to 1, the variance parameter corresponding to 1 as well, I think. Now, if one for each of these samples from the simple linear regression model computes the beta parameter estimates, which are of course two-dimensional because we have the offset and the slope parameter, then we see that they basically cluster here in this kind of thin line in beta parameter space, and center roughly around 1, 1, which is the true but unknown parameter value. Now the result that we've seen here, this here, is of course a description of the probability density function of the beta parameter estimates, and this is what is plotted here. So this is the frequentist sampling, and this is the analytical result. So this is kind of a sampling validation of this result. Now, how this distribution of, in this case, simple linear regression parameters looks, that depends on, of course, the variance parameter sigma square and the details of the design matrix. And depending on the details of the design matrix, one either has very little variance or more variance, and one has more or less covariance. These details, how that looks like, this is what we will discuss when we discuss simple linear regression in a little bit more depth. Today the point is that the beta hat or the beta parameter estimates are distributed according to a multivariate Gaussian, which is just a consequence of the linear fine transformation theorem for Gaussian random variables, because we just have a linear transformation of a Gaussian random variable here. So why is a multivariate Gaussian? We multiply this with a matrix, and hence beta hat is also a Gaussian. What is a little bit more tricky in terms of the mathematics, and hence only partially explained so far in the script, but with actually, I said earlier, you shouldn't read other literature. Of course you should read other literature, but the literature that I cite, so I'm referring to the book by Seba. So I mean, you can read any literature, but you you might also trust me that I looked through a lot of literature, and certain things I found helpful and other things I didn't find helpful, and the things that I found helpful, they they are included as references in the script. Now, what is happening with the distribution of the variance parameter is that, in fact, a scaled version of the variance parameter, namely if you multiply the variance parameter estimate by n minus p, so n being the number of data points, p the number of parameters, and you divide this by the true but unknown parameter, by sigma square, then this entity is distributed according to a chi-square distribution. So remember that chi-square distributions refer to the distributions of squared standard normal random variables, and with a little bit more of an effort than actually is necessary to show that the better parameter estimates are normally distributed, one can show that the variance parameter estimates, if scaled according with this coefficient here, are chi-squared distributed with n minus p degrees of freedom. Now, what's part of the intuition here? Well, first of all, the variance estimates take on values on the in the positive real numbers, right? So variances are never negative, and they of course result from the residual errors, which are sums of squares. So we can't expect a Gaussian distribution here, because Gaussian distributions are always symmetric and extend over the entire real line. So we need to, so definitely the not everything can be Gaussian, and the variance parameter estimates, they are non-Gaussian distributed, and they are distributed according to a chi-square distribution, and that is visualized here. So again, I have a simple linear regression design, and now I took many more samples from this, so I think 1,000, and all these gray lines that you can not really see here, but you can imagine that there are many gray lines which then form this gray shaded area, as you can see here. They are all referred to samples, and then I obtain this set of variance parameter estimates. Then I can of course do a histogram analysis of that, and if I look at the histogram analysis here, the distribution of these variance parameter estimates takes this shape. Only on the they are of course never negative, because it's always sums of squares divided by n minus p, and yeah, they roughly align with, in terms of the most likely thing that I have in the sample, with the true but unknown variance parameter. And finally, the analytical result that I just stated is shown here. So if one doesn't look at the histogram of the variance parameter estimates, but at the scaled variance parameter estimates, and then this histogram, if it's normalized to estimate a probability density function, corresponds to the chi-squared distribution with n minus p degrees of freedom. So the main point here again being that, first of all, the GLM, like any frequentist model, comes with this sampling intuition that you can repeatedly sample this model. Always keep in mind that, maybe we put a little star here after all, that your own data is just one of the many samples that you could take, and that also the results that you have, so your head beta, which of course would be your estimated slope and offset parameters for simple linear regression, or your estimated mean, that these are just one of the samples that you could take from your model, and then also your estimates also correspond to only one of the many estimates that you could hypothetically sample from your model. And based on the transformation of random variables, that we discussed when we discuss probability theory. One can analytically evaluate the distributions of the beta parameter estimates and the variance parameter estimates, and it turns out that the beta parameter estimates are distributed multivariate normal. They are unbiased in the sense that the expected value of the beta parameter estimates is the true but unknown value, and a scaled version of the variance parameter estimate is chi-square distributed. And you see a sketch of a proof in that in the script. Okay, so that's essentially what I wanted to do in the first hour, a little bit quicker than I initially thought, but we discussed the frequentist sampling intuition and the frequentist distributions of beta hat and sigma square hat. And in the second hour now, we want to introduce the t-statistic to get ready for hypothesis testing. Are there any questions right now? Maybe I put in your observed data. And these are hypothetical distributions, although that's it's a little bit of a tautology, hypothetical distributions, because probability distributions per se are hypothetical. They are theoretical entities that don't exist in the real world. Now, okay, so if there are no current questions, then I suggest we take a break, and after the break introduce the t-statistic and its distribution, which, careful, spoiler alert, will be a t-distribution. Okay, let's take a break and continue at 10:30. Okay, then let us continue with the second main topic today, namely the t-statistic. Before we continue, are there questions regarding the content of the previous hour? So anything that remained unclear? Apparently not. I just thought that this would be a little bit nicer here. Good, so then the topic now is the t-statistic and its frequentist distribution. And of course the t-statistic is one of the key statistics that one always encounters. Here we encounter it in the context of the GLM. And one of the reasons why I'm putting quite some emphasis here on that is, of course, if you do basic fMRI data analysis in the context of statistical parametric mapping, you often see t-maps, and to get them you need to specify contrast vectors and so on. And this is why I this is one of the many reasons why I introduced the t-statistic in the context of the GLM here. We will now not discuss t-tests or something like this, so statistical testing, so the theory of statistical testing, that's the content of next week, and doing t-tests is then the content of the session on t-tests and simple linear regression. Today we just introduce the t-statistic and look at its frequentist distribution. And we start with a definition of the t-statistic, and I write it here in function form, which is more or less helpful. So one can do it, but one does not need to. But to start thinking about the t-statistic, it's definitely helpful. So assume that, or let's define tc, which the c later on will be clear that this refers to something centralized. No, sorry, now I confuse myself. No, the C does not refer to something centralized, but it refers to a contrast vector. Hello? The C refers to a contrast vector. Assume that you have a contrast vector C that is of the same dimensionality as your beta parameter vector. So we assume that we have some C in WRP. Then the t-statistic is defined as a function from the beta parameter space and the variance space, or better, the variance estimator space. So this is why we allow the zero here to be there. Although if we have the zero there, then we actually divide by zero, so we don't want to allow it. So this can we also change that in the script. So our t-statistic is a function from the Cartesian product space of the p-dimensional real vectors and the positive real numbers to the real numbers. And this is already a key feature. So it takes beta parameter estimates, it takes variance parameter estimates, and it returns a single number. Yeah, beta parameter estimates can be as high dimensional as your columns space of your design matrix, so as many independent variables as you have. And of course, you always have one variance parameter estimator, so, but the t-statistic is always just a single number. And it allocates to each value of your estimators the value of the t-statistic for these estimates, and this is defined as follows. And that's now the crucial thing. The contrast vector transpose times beta hat. So that's one of the key factors. So you multiply in a matrix multiplication sense, or in this case a dot product of two vectors, you multiply the contrast vector with the beta hat parameter estimator. And of course the dot product is a scalar, so it's a single number. So you combine all your beta parameter estimates in a linear fashion. And you divide this by the square root of the variance parameter estimate times the transpose of the contrast vector times the inverse of this design matrix cross or self product, and you multiply again by the contrast vector. So think for a second what you have here in the denominator. So C is p dimensional, so the transpose of C is 1 times p dimensional. The transpose, so the inverse, so this whole thing in here is p times p dimensional, so it's a square matrix. You can compute its inverse, which is also p times p dimensional. So you have 1 times p times p times p times p times 1. So you also, and this is of course also a scalar, so you also get a scalar in the denominator. So you have a the ratio of two scalars, and that's the t-statistic. And to form the t-statistic, or the t-statistic, of course, depends on this contrast vector here. And the contrast vector allows you to evaluate linear combinations of better parameter estimates. So for example, if you want to check, or if you want to see whether one of the better parameter estimates is larger than the other, then you can, for example, if you have two better parameter estimates, so your better hat takes this form. Then, and if you're interested in the difference of your better parameter estimates, so for example, whether the difference is positive or negative, if the difference is positive, then obviously better one hat is larger than better two hat, and the reverse is true if the difference is a negative. To evaluate this difference, you would then define a contrast vector C as 1 minus 1, because if you pre-multiply this with beta, then you get beta 1 hat minus beta 2 hat, and then you have the difference, and then you might be interested in whether this difference is larger or smaller than 0. These are typical contrast vectors you see in fMRI. Actually, I will obviously not teach the GLM fMRI part, but if you look at stuff that we did, for example, last year, you can go all into the logic of contrast for fMRI in the lecture notes that I have on that. We are more interested in the general setting here for the moment. Now, that's the definition of the t-statistic, but of course it's not that intuitively appealing. So there's a dot product, there's a square root, and so on. So it makes sense to have a look at an example to get some intuition about this t-statistic. Of course, it always depends with the t-statistic on the specific GLM design that you're dealing with. And here in this example, I'm looking at the GLM implementation or incarnation of IID Gaussian samples. So your Gaussian population, maybe, as you call it in undergrad statistics. And here this then takes obviously this form. So this is, we already discussed that actually last time and multiple times previously. So we have our y distributed according to, of course, x beta, and we assume that our x, our design matrix, is given by a column of ones, and our beta parameter is given by or we can also call our beta, our single beta that we have, mu. We can also just call it beta. In general, it's always called mu. And if you think about population parameters again, so that's why this mu is somewhat helpful here. And then we've seen already that our beta hat in this case, if we evaluate the estimator for beta, then we get, of course, xt, x to the power of minus 1. So that's a column of 1s transpose times a column of 1s. That's just, and then, yeah, multiplied and summed up. So that's just n. Then the inverse of that is 1 over n. And xt, if it's a column of 1s, times y, just corresponds to the sum of the y's. So we've seen already that this is just the sample mean, so which we can write as bar y. So our better head estimator just corresponds to the sample mean. We've already seen that. And what we also have seen is that our variance estimator corresponds to the sample variance. So our p is 1 here, so n minus p corresponds to n minus 1, and our residual sum of squares can be written as yi minus bar y, oops, and the whole thing. And the whole thing squared. So this is what we've seen previously in terms of the estimates. And now for this example, we want to evaluate the t-statistic. So we see here that our t-statistic for, in this case, then of course, here y bar, first of all needs a contrast vector. Well, the contrast vector here, well, we could scale our mean here, but there's also not really a reason to. So let's just set our c to 1. Then we get here 1 times hat beta times the sample mean. And down here we have 1 times this we've already seen, that this is 1 over n. Times 1. So if we continue with the evaluation of the t-statistic here, then we get 1 times our sample mean is just our sample mean. And here we have 1 over n, so we have our sample variance divided by n. And if we divide by a ratio, we can also multiply with the inverse, so we can also rewrite this as square root of n times our sample mean, and we have the square root of, we also called this previously the sample variance. So here we can put the sample variance, it's just the same thing. So we have this divide by the square root of the sample variance, which is of course the sample standard deviation. And if you did any undergraduate statistics, this version of the t statistic should be familiar to you. So so the t statistic always has been, whatever statistics you take, defined as the sample mean divided by the sample standard deviation and multiplied by the square root of n. And this is, of course, just the t-statistic in the scenario of IRD sampling of univariate Gaussians. Of course, t-statistics look different if you use different GLMs, but for this GLM, it looks like this. And this then also, of course, gives you a sign of a kind of an intuition of what the t-statistic wants to do. So of course you can understand your sample mean as a measure of the effect size, or let's for this moment just call it the sample mean, effect. So because if your effect is zero, then your sample mean should be zero as well. And if your effect is positive, then your sample mean is also positive. So maybe let's call that, let's call it sample mean. The problem is, if as soon as I put effect size here, people go crazy because of Cohen's d, because they are so have it very strongly in their mind that effect size is Cohen's d. So I rather call it sample mean here. And then we divide the sample mean by some sample standard deviation. And multiply this by the square root of the sample size, which of course also means that if you take larger samples, your t values will always increase. And yeah, in a little bit more abstract form, you can also understand this as if you are happy with the fact that sample means are effect sizes and that Cohen's d is just one of the many ways you can call something effect size. And here you have effect variability, or data variability, maybe even better. So that's then the intuition. So in a t value, in a t statistic, you summarize the size of your effect and the variability of your data in a single number. That's why some people have a hard time interpreting t values, but it's a single number that expresses how large your effect is with in units of your standard deviation. So if your t value is 1, then your effect size is as large as your standard deviation, given that you have a sample size of 1. So for because otherwise you need to scale it. And if your t value is 4, then your effect size is 4 times as high as your standard deviation. If again your sample size is 1, if you have larger sample size, then you don't need that much of an increase of your sample mean or effect size over your data variability. Yeah, so this is the basic intuition for t values. And this is what you then also should also read from t-values. So sometimes people say, we don't want to do any null hypothesis testing anymore because Bayesian is so much better. And I like Bayesian stuff, but it's not so much better. It's just different. The thing with a t-statistic is, first of all, a t-statistic is not inherently a t-test. These are two different things. What tests are we discuss next week? And t values are just one number summaries of the ratio of your effect size or your beta parameter estimate and their variability. Of course, they look a little bit more complex once you go to more complex GLMs, but the essence of this intuition remains. Yeah, I think that's what I wanted to say about t-statistics. And the next thing would be then to study the frequentist distribution and the frequentist distribution of the centralized t-statistic. Are there questions about the t-statistic right now?
I was wondering if you could give a basic intuition of the contrast vector.
Naja, the contrast vector is just a means to look at different linear combinations of your beta parameters. And in this example, it's a means to look at whether look at the difference of two beta parameter estimates. Another example would be that you want to, so what the contrast vector does, first of all, it projects your p-dimensional beta parameter estimates onto a scalar number because you form this dot product. And then of course you can also, if you sometimes are only interested in certain beta parameter estimates, for example because you have variables, independent variables of no interest that you have in your model and you estimate the beta parameter estimates but you're not really interested in them, and for example you only want to look at the slope parameter in a simple linear regression design, then you can use contrast vectors like this here, this one zero, that then gives you just the better hat one better parameter estimate. So there is not really an intuition to this contrast vector, it's just a tool that allows you to project your better parameter estimates onto a scalar number in different ways. And if you want to isolate better parameter estimates, you can use these 1, 0, 0 vectors. If you want to look at differences between better parameter estimates, you can use this 1, -1 vectors, and that's almost everything that you can do with contrast vectors.
Thank you.
Good. So that was the t-statistic, and so that we can actually use the t-statistic in hypothesis testing in the GLM context later on, what we need is the frequentist distribution of the centralized t-statistic, because there are two core t distributions in statistics. One is the central t distribution, and the other one is the non-central t distribution, which you always need in the context of power analysis. And we focus here on the centralized t statistic. And the centralized t statistic is defined similar but not completely identical to the t statistic. The difference is that in the centralized t-statistics also depends on a value of the true but unknown parameter. And this relates, of course, to the fact that you often want to do something called null hypothesis testing, where you assume that the null hypothesis holds, and null hypotheses, as we will learn next week, are statements about parameters. And if your statement is that a nil hypothesis, so no effect holds, then your statement would be that your true but unknown better parameters are zero, and then you are interested in evaluating the centralized t-statistic, which takes your true but unknown better parameters into account. The difference hence in the definition of the t-statistic, which is something that you evaluate based on data, and the centralized t-statistic, which is something where you plug in the true but unknown parameters, so you cannot evaluate that in real life, is this centering of the t-statistic around its true but unknown value in terms of the better parameters. So that's the difference. The main point of doing this, so that's the, I call it not centralized, centered t-statistic. So the thing about the centered t-statistic is that the centered t-statistic is distributed according to a t-distribution with n minus p degrees of freedom. So that's the core theorem. So that's theorem 9.41, distribution of the centered t-statistic. The centered t-statistic is distributed according to a t-distribution with n minus p degrees of freedom. So remember that a t-distribution is the distribution of a random variable. Let's call that call it xi for the time being, that is defined as the ratio of a standard normal random variable divided by the square root of a chi-square random variable, let's call that epsilon, divided by its degrees of freedom, let's call that nu. So the t-distribution is the distribution of xi, and xi is defined as the ratio of zeta being standard normal and the square root of a chi-square random variable with nu degrees of freedom divided by nu. Now that's the definition of the t-distribution, and it's not necessarily immediately clear, at least not to me, that this definition of the center t-statistic actually corresponds to this t-random variable here. Maybe I should call it t-random variable. T-random variable. A little bit confusing is here, of course, that everything is called t, but that's just because the t-distribution usually is introduced with respect to the t-statistics, so there's a close association between the two, specifically if the center t-statistic is distributed according to a t-distribution. But to actually see that this is the case, and that the center t-statistic thus has the PDF of a t-random variable, one actually needs to show that this expression here is actually a standard normal random variable divided by the square root of a chi-square random variable with p degrees of freedom, or in this case n minus p degrees of freedom divided by n minus p. And yeah, this is then the last thing that I want to do today. So to see that this is actually the case, so to show that this is the case, one needs to rewrite the t-statistic a little bit, and this can be done as follows. So we start with the definition, and then we multiply both the denominator and the numerator by the square root of n minus p, and also look a little bit at what we have there in the numerator. So we have the square root of sigma square hat, which we can give its own square root sign based on the rules of exponentiation. And we can, and another thing that's happening here is that we multiply by the true but unknown variance parameter and its inverse. Yeah, and the inverse of this, so 1 over this. So nothing has changed, we just wrote some additional stuff in there, which will be helpful in a second. And then we can take this ratio a little bit apart. So we take give this divided by the square root of now the square root of the true but unknown parameter times the contrast vector in the design matrices, give that its own ratio, and hence we get rid of this here, and we get rid of this here, this. And hence have here n minus p divided by sigma square. That's fine. The sigma square here we put under the same square root, but I want to so n minus p divided by the true but unknown. It doesn't do my ratio here. Do a ratio, con. And we do it like this. So, and there we have this square root of, and yeah, then we are almost there, because here this thing from the numerator we can put into the denominator, and then get here 1 divided by the square root of n minus p divided by sigma square times sigma square hat. But we need it a little bit nicer here now. I need some. So that's what we need. N minus p divided by sigma square sigma hat square, and this thing here is divided by square root of n minus p and that's almost it. So let's continue with the former term a little bit, because here we can now put everything under one square root, and then we are already there. Because what we've seen previously is that this thing here is chi-square distributed, so n minus p divided by the true but unknown variance parameter times the variance parameter estimate is chi-square distributed, and then we divide it by n minus p, so this thing here is already of the form that we are interested in, because our epsilon here is this. So we already have the denominator safe, and the last thing to show then is that the numerator, so what I just put in the numerator here, is actually a standard normal random variable, so this can also be seen relatively straightforwardly if we appreciate that CT beta hat minus CT beta is distributed according to a multivariate Gaussian centered on zero, because the expected value here of beta hat is beta, and we subtract beta from it, and the C doesn't do a contribution. One can also do that with the linear transformation theorem. That was just a heuristic approach essentially, and it has the covariance corresponding to the covariance of beta hat, and this we've seen also in the first hour this morning, that this is given by again 0 and sigma squared xt x to the power of minus 1 like this. And now with the Z transformation theorem, which corresponds to of course subtracting the expected value, and which we don't have to do here because it's already centered on zero, and dividing by the square root, sorry there, I forgot the CT, dividing by the square root of its covariance, like here, we get a standard normal distributed entity. So what we then have seen is that, to summarize that, that in this expression here, this thing is distributed according to a standard normal distribution, and this essentially this thing here, as we've seen previously, is distributed according to a chi-square distribution with n minus p degrees of freedom, and hence we've rewritten the center t statistic as a t-random variable that has that corresponds to the ratio of a standard uniform random variable and the square root of a chi-square random variable divided by its degrees of freedom, as you can see here. Maybe let's do something that is very helpful. Let's write Z transformation. So that's essentially, in a nutshell, to show that the centralized or center t statistic is distributed according to a t distribution, because the PDF of a t distribution is already established in the probability distribution setting and derives from combining appropriately the standard normal distribution with the chi-squared distribution. Good, so that's essentially what I wanted to do today. So let's summarize again. So we started with the frequentist sampling intuition so that we can repeatedly sample. And this entails that the parameter estimates of the GLM parameters and any statistics that we compute based on these parameter estimates, like the t-statistics, have their hypothetical distributions. That, and this is the power of the GLM framework, can be analytically evaluated based on the transformation of random variables. And because we start from Gaussians, that's relatively straightforward, and the results are long known for a long time. Then the results are that the beta parameter estimates are multivariate Gaussian distributed, this scaled version of the variance parameter estimates is chi-square distributed, and that was what we did in the first hour. And then in the second hour we introduced the t-statistic in its form as applicable to the GLM, which can, of course, depending on the specific GLM design matrix, can then look different. We looked at one example, namely the Gaussian IRD case, where the design matrix just corresponds to a column of ones and the beta parameter is just the beta parameter and corresponds to mu. And in this case, we recover the familiar t statistic that you've seen in one sample t tests in undergrad statistics. And we see again that the t statistic is a one number summary of the ratio between effect sizes and variability that depends on the sample size. So, higher sample size, higher t values. And finally, we looked at the sampling distribution, or the distribution of the centered t-statistic, which forms the basis for null hypothesis testing, as introduced last week. And we've shown that this centered t-statistic can be rewritten as there's something missing. Can be rewritten as the ratio of a standard normal random variable and the square root of a chi-square random variable with n minus p degrees of freedom divided by n minus p. Hence, it has a t distribution. T distribution, because there are two t distributions, the t distribution that we've seen today, which is always centered on zero, and the non-central t distribution. And actually, if beta is only if the true but unknown value of beta is actually zero, then the center t-statistic and the t-statistic have the same distribution. If the true but unknown beta is not zero, then of course the estimates also will not be zero on average, and then of course you don't get a distribution here that is centered on zero. The only thing that is centered on zero is the center t-statistic. But one can also discuss the distribution of the non-centered t-statistic, and this is actually a non-centered t-distribution. Good. That's what I wanted to do today. Next week we will then investigate what statistical testing actually means. And I think then that's it in terms of the general concepts, because after that we will then discuss different designs and then basically reintroduce things that you heard before, t-test, simple linear regression, multiple linear regression, ANOVA and COVA, and see how they look from the perspective of the GLM. And I can already tell you how they look from the perspective of the GLM in general. They look like this, and that's the power of the GLM, because then all these things are the same thing. One thing, another statistic that is of course very important and we will also encounter is the F statistic, which of course plays a big role in ANOVA, and we can of course also include here the F statistic. We will see the F statistic when we discuss one-way ANOVA. And I will show you the equivalence between the GLM way of addressing one-way ANOVA and the error sum of squares partitioning that you may or may not have seen in undergrad statistics. Good, so that's it for today. Any remaining questions? Apparently not. So then we meet again at 3 p.m. for neurocognitive methods in programming. First for the... I'm actually not quite clear. Maybe we do the presentation first, because it's fairly related to an introduction of fMRI, and then we do the Q&A session afterwards. Maybe that's nicer. So let's meet at 3 p.m. and do the presentation on MR safety and the basics of an MR experiment. And then after that, we do questions. And if you have, if you don't have questions regarding neurocognitive methods, but some questions regarding statistical methods, we can of course also address them there. Only we will have to stop at 5. Okay. Then see you later.